sun, thousands of miles from home, would remain forever in the strange lands where they had given up their lives. In the United States, demobilization after World War II came fast. The hardware of war was scrapped for iron to supply assembly lines, which had been converted back to the production of peacetime goods. For progress, it has been said, there is no cure. There was no converting back from the atomic age. But an attempt was made by the United States to stop an atomic arms race before it could begin. In 1946, speaking before the United Nations, Bernard Baruch offered a proposal for the international control of all atomic energy.
We are here to make a choice between the quick and the dead. That is our business.
The proposal was not adopted. In 3 years, President Truman would make the announcement that the Soviet Union had detonated its own first atomic bomb. The war had ravaged Europe. 4 years accumulation of Nazi oppression, air raids, bitter land fighting and leveled cities, ruined farms, wrecked factories, shattered family ties, and killed and maimed millions. The United States offered massive help. The European Recovery Program, the Marshall Plan, was open to all. But amid growing strain between the West and the Soviet Union, Eastern European countries rejected it. Under the Marshall Plan, billions of dollars in building materials, tools for industry, farm machinery, were sent to Western Europe, and with will and determination, it began rebuilding. In a remarkably short time, its economy was to become stronger than ever. Berlin, 1948. With relations deteriorating between the Soviet Union and the West, restrictions were put on surface traffic into Western-controlled sectors of the city. For West Berlin, located completely within East Germany, it was, in effect, a blockade. In response, the Western powers began supplying the city with food and other necessities through a massive airlift. It was not until 17 months had passed and British and United States planes had airlifted over 2 million tons of food and coal that the blockade was finally lifted. For the Western nations, remembering Hitler and the hard-learned lesson that weakness can be an invitation to aggression, the preservation of peace and stability lay in part in collective security. The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, was formed. Troops of 15 nations would march under its flag. Out to Europe, on the other side of the world, to divided, unstable Korea, came the first large-scale military clash of the atomic age. On June 25th, 1950, as refugees fled south, the misery of man slaughtering man began again. With the Soviet Union absent, the United Nations Security Council was able to request military assistance for South Korea. Eventually, 17 countries joined to fight under the UN flag. The military objective of the United Nations was to restore Korea to its pre-attack boundaries. It was, in this sense, a limited war, the first of its kind. It was a war to deter aggression, to make it unprofitable. A military action to control the danger of a larger war. After 3 years of fighting, after many months of negotiation, the objective was finally achieved. In a period of revolution in technology, a space race had begun. Now, under continued east-west tension, it accelerated. Both sides developed rocket engines with ever-increasing thrust and range. With Sputnik 1, the Soviet Union was first to put a satellite into orbit around the Earth. As a prelude to putting the first man into space, it was soon conducting experiments with human beings and investigating the bizarre phenomenon of weightlessness. Rock rockets which could put a man into orbit could also hurl H-bombs across oceans. Both the United States and the Soviet Union developed medium-range and long-range ballistic missiles. Both developed nuclear-powered submarines capable of remaining submerged and undetected for months and of firing missiles with nuclear warheads. For the two powers, fear and dislike of each other was increasingly matched by fear of the spiraling arms race and the danger of nuclear catastrophe. Tacit agreements sprang up, agreements which recognized that mutual deterrence was not automatic, that the military equilibrium was far from unshakable, that it was in fact precarious and would need constant attention and care by both countries. 1962, October. A photo reconnaissance flight over Cuba, 90 miles from the United States, confirmed what for weeks had been rumored. In great secrecy and haste, medium and intermediate range missiles of the Soviet Union were being set up on the island. The balance of missile strength was about to undergo an ominous shift. In Washington, evidence was quietly analyzed, courses of action debated. On the seventh day of the still secret crisis, President Kennedy went on radio and television to reveal the missile buildup and to state the position and the controlled response of the United States.
First, to halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, will, if found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back. Second, I have directed the continued and increased close surveillance of Cuba and its military buildup. Should these offensive military preparations continue, thus increasing the threat to the hemisphere, further action will be justified. Third, it shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union. We will not prematurely or unnecessarily risk the course of worldwide nuclear war, in which even the fruits of victory would be ashes in our mouth. But neither will we shrink from that risk at any time it must be faced.
The crisis was brought before the United Nations by Adlai Stevenson.
All right, sir. Let me ask you one simple question. Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no? Don't wait for the translation. Yes or no?
I am not in an American courtroom, sir, and therefore I do not wish to answer a question that is put to me in the fashion in which a prosecutor does. In due course, sir, you will have your reply.
I'm prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over, if that's your decision.
It was the Soviet Union's turn to call the next move. Soviet ships approaching Cuba knew the United States Navy had orders to intercept them and to inspect their cargoes. The world waited and watched. Then a few Soviet ships were reported altering course. Another permitted inspection. Finally, after six anxiety-ridden days, the Soviet Union, acting also with restraint and control, agreed to withdraw the Cuban missiles. And the world could breathe again. The tide of Cold War tensions now reversed. Ambassador Averell Harriman returned to the United States from Moscow, where he had succeeded in negotiating a treaty which banned atmospheric and underwater tests of nuclear weapons. Accompanied by Secretary of State Dean Rusk, he reported to the vacationing president. Later in Moscow, the agreement was signed by the United States, the Soviet Union, and Great Britain. It would eventually bear the signatures of 100 more nations. Not the millennium. Not the coming of goodwill to the hearts of all men, but a verifiable agreement in the self-interest of all. A practical first step toward international cooperation and arms control.